Hello, everyone. My name is Brian Solis, and welcome to the revolution. You can't smell this, but I can. It's bacon. And here to greet us with bacon is the CEO of Revision3, Jim Louderback. Jim?
Good to see you, and I would like to be the first on your show to offer you some bacon.
I would be actually very happy to take bacon.
I have a lot of bacon here, and you're probably wondering why I brought you bacon.
Well, no, I was actually wondering when I could eat it. But yes, why did you bring bacon?
Do you want to eat it now?
No, I'll wait.
Okay, here,
I'll
well, why don't you put it back on my paper towel and I'll give it back to you. The reason why I brought bacon is because today's a big day for Revision 3. We just brought on a hugely successful YouTube channel called Epic Mealtime. These guys do like 2-3 million views an episode, and they're all about making things. Bacon is just one of the condiments that they use when they make their epic mealtimes, but bacon is a very important piece of it. So I thought I'd share bacon with everybody here and your crew and you as well.
I appreciate that.
I'm just gonna leave it right here there, see. Have some bacon.
Well, Jim, thanks for bringing the bacon.
Sure. Yeah, I'm always bringing the bacon. For you, Brian.
Thank you. The question I have for you, so you brought on a new show mm-hmm. to Revision 3, but why don't we take a couple steps back and talk a little bit about what Revision 3 is. You and I go back probably too many years that I'll admit on camera. You've always challenged media. You've pushed media forward in some very interesting ways, in admirable ways. And here you are, CEO of one of the web's most popular. How would you even define Revision 3?
Yeah, it's really simple. We are an internet television network. We're a television network, but we don't have towers to broadcast with. We don't have cable and satellite to go out on. We have the internet. We have IP. But we create shows, like episodic shows. They show up every week or every day. We go out and find really talented creators who can create shows and communities around them and bring them into Revision 3. And we make these shows available all around the web, on big screens, on small screens, on TVs, on YouTube, on our own site, on Metacafe. Really everywhere anybody wants to watch video, our shows show up.
What kind of audiences are you seeing with these shows, and what is it that you offer through the web that traditional networks can't provide?
So we are, the audiences overall, we're reaching about 16, 17 million, you know, kind of uniques a month across everything we do. A show like Epic Mealtime averages 2 million views an episode. They do an episode every week. Some of them have gotten 4 or 5 million. We do. We also have these guys, a politics show, politics, news, culture, called The Young Turks. They do roughly 20 or 30 million views a month across all the stuff that they do. So we're talking really big numbers. But the thing that we do that traditional television can't is we can go after a core demographic. We can go after an audience, a community, if you will, and super serve them with a type of content, with a host that sits at the center of it, but not worry about lowest common denominator ratings. I don't care that I have to appeal to everybody. I only have to appeal to a core demo, a core community, and have them love it and super serve them. We met, well, one of the times I know we worked together when I was at a cable network called ZDTV, which became Tech TV. We did shows about technology. We put these shows out. When we first launched, we launched on a cable system in Las Vegas, and then back before the internet and before little satellite dishes, people had these huge satellite dishes, and basically it was rural. So people, you had cows in the front yard and satellite dishes in the backyard. And we launched on these big satellite dishes in rural America, and we would get these emails from these people, and they would be like, oh my God, I'm in a town of 500 people. I did not know there were other geeks like me. And this was really pre-internet, where people could come together. Internet was just coming out. It was, you know, 1998. And so we built these shows built around real hosts, geeks like me. I'm a geek, I'm not a TV personality. Leo Laporte, Patrick Norton. And we would build these shows around these guys, and they were real and authentic. We had great communities, people loved it, and then we got rated by Nielsen. And when you're rated by Nielsen, you can't sell quality of audience. We had this incredible audience of geeks. They bought a lot of computers and technology and the internet, and they were highly valuable, and they were opinion leaders. Didn't matter. With Nielsen, it was all about your ratings. And that's why, as a network, our more popular shows started getting replaced by repeats of The Thunderbirds. Remember The Thunderbirds?
Oh my goodness.
The puppet show?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what happens on traditional television, whether it's cable, satellite, or broadcast. You get rated, and you have to get the most viewers you can, because that's the only way you can get more money. Whereas for us, we build these totally epic communities around the shows and the hosts, and because they're so valuable and we can prove it to advertisers, we can charge a lot of money for that, and we do.
Well, there's this saying, especially in new media, that less is more. We are focusing again on quality versus quantity. We are focusing more on interest versus social graphs, for example. And there's, you used it earlier, it's authentic. There's an authentic quality to that that people can relate to. And I think that's part of the magic of the social web today. And it's definitely what we see in terms of YouTube sensations and Revision 3 able to market programs that service particular genres and interests. You're talking about 16 million, right? Network television is talking about greater numbers. However, having created a show here for YouTube myself, those to me are incredible numbers to aspire to. What do you notice is different about community building around content online versus offline?
Well, so look, all media is about community. I mean, this whole community thing didn't start with the internet, right? I mean, heck, I was on CompuServe in the late 80s. But, you know, even back in magazines, I was editor-in-chief of magazines. We had letters to the editor. That was a community. You know, television in the 50s, people would watch Howdy Doody and then talk about it on the playground the next day. But with the internet, it's the immediacy and the connectedness, and also the fact that you can build a community without borders. So when I talked about, I see a great television show and I talk about it the next morning at the office, it's just the people sitting next to me, the water cooler, physical. Now communities can emerge really quickly, they can come together like lightning, and they can do it without physical borders. So we remove physicality, we remove location, and what we do is we let people of like-minded interest come together without those physical barriers, and that's what the internet does really well. And so I just call it community building on steroids. It's what we've always been doing as media people, it's just now we're doing it much more quickly.
2 million views per episode, how did they build that audience?
You know, they're an example of, again, something you can build really quickly on the internet. They just did their 26th episode as their first one with Revision 3. And they've been doing an episode every week. So they launched in October or November. And they got this huge audience. So part of it is the ability for something that is so good and so funny and so out there and like nothing you've ever seen to find an audience really quickly. Because they put it out on YouTube. People found it. They like started passing it around. It was so cool that it hit that gestalt right there. You know, part of it is, you know, just to go back to bacon for a minute. I mean, look, bacon is cool, right? I mean, we've got bacon salt, we've got wrapping in bacon, you know, bacon martinis, baconators at Wendy's. So bacon is a cool thing. So they were able to take bacon and this amazing fast food, they just did wacky out stuff. And because of the ability on YouTube to quickly pass things to other people and to quickly build audiences, they were able to build that so rapidly so that they're doing, you know, 800,000 subscribers.
And this is the thing that I admire so great about just the web, but particularly the social web, is that content becomes something that you can immediately experience on demand and then share it. And that implied endorsement with sharing within your community becomes huge. It's a one-to-one-to-many ratio that I think has not seen its equal in history.
Well, the other thing is, and you know, back in the day, before the internet, you know, somebody liked a show, they would tell 5 or 10 people. Now, our audience, they've got 200 Facebook friends. They've got 150 followers on Twitter. So when they share something or tell something about someone, the amplification effect is so much greater. So it's not just one person telling 5 people who tell 5 people who tell 5 people. It's one to say, like, 200, so 300. I mean, you can get to scale so quickly because of that.
Does that design into how people are creating their shows, knowing that they can trigger the social effect?
You know, it changes the way you build your audience and talk to your audience. I think in the end, you know, for us, it's all about that authentic person that sits at the center. We don't do comedies and dramas. We don't try and do traditional television. We take a person at the center of the show, one or two hosts, who know what they're talking about. So it's, we call it experts, not actors. You know, we don't put those like bubble-headed blondes who know how to read a teleprompter, don't have a brain in their head. They're not our hosts. Our hosts are, you know, like you. You're a freaking expert. You're amazing. You have this great show, and that's what people want. They don't want, you know, some guy with a coiffed hair who's able to read a teleprompter about social media. They want you. It's the same thing about the shows that we do. So that's one. Two, there are tricks and things that you do to talk to your audience to get them to share. So, you know, anybody who watches YouTube knows. You watch a good YouTube guy, he's like, hey, thanks for watching. Thanks, and make sure you comment and rate and subscribe and tell all your friends. Oh, and by the way, give me a thumbs up, okay? And if you tell someone to give you a thumbs up in your video, you're like 10 times more likely to get thumbs up. Or on Facebook, if you say, please like me, people will like you. People respond to that. You wouldn't see Walter Cronkite saying, duh, you know, rate me, subscribe me. That's not what he would do.
Guys, we're taking notes, right? Hold on a second, I have to read my next question. And Jim, thank you for joining us on this show. Please talk to us about monetization.
Here now, the news. Monetization is important. Thank you very much. Now, so look, that's another area where it's funny. The monetization that we do is very much, I mean, we do pre-rolls and overlays and that stuff, but a lot of it is taking those authentic hosts who have real communities built around them of hundreds of thousands of people, and we use those hosts to introduce brands to the community. It's not like they're sitting there on the show and there's, you know, bacon. Instead of just having bacon, it would be like Oakdale Farms bacon, you know? it's really natural in the middle of like, hey, you know what? These shows are free. Sponsors pay for the shows. Now we're gonna talk about our sponsors. And the hosts themselves will talk about products or services that sponsor. But the important thing is it's not just any brand. It's gotta be one that the hosts really trust and know and love, because they're a little bit on the line there. A few years ago, we had a branch of the military that wanted to sponsor some of our shows. Some of our hosts were okay with it. Some of our hosts weren't. The hosts that weren't, we didn't run the sponsorship in there. And that's really important, because yes, it's a sponsorship, but it has to come from the heart for it to be effective. And it has to be something that they believe in. And so when you get that, when that works really well, when you bring in a product and the host of the show introduces it to their community, the results are tremendous. So we get 100% unaided recall, 57% buy a product or service. And the reason why is this community appeal. I keep on going back to the community, but one of the guy who used to run our fan group in New York said it best. He said, it's not a fan base, it's a friend base. Everybody in that, you know, think about the social graph, and you know, you got your social graph. All those people are in some way connected because they love the show. They identify as a Dignation fan or a Tuxilla fan or an Epic Mealtime fan. That's something that they wear on their chest as a badge, or you know, sometimes with a t-shirt, sometimes just in their mind. But the hosts themselves are a spike on the social graph. They have a lot more influence than any of the others. So when that host says something, if it makes sense and it's true and it's believable, great. But if you do it in the wrong way, you pull the wolves out, you diminish their trust, so the spike becomes a little less spiky, a little less spiky. Right. So that's really important too.